Hello and welcome everyone to the United Methodist Church of Palm Springs. My name is Jeremy and I'm on staff here at the church, and I'm excited to welcome you to worship today. We have a great new series that we're exploring on the hero's journey. So you may be familiar with Joseph Campbell's famous work on the subject, but today as we look at the character of Moses, we learn about the idea of the refusal of call. And I'm sure none of us have experienced that before. Now, in just a moment, our music director, Wayne, is going to play some music for us. It's a great opportunity to prepare our hearts and minds for worship, and also just to say hi in the comments and connect with one another. As an icebreaker, why don't we share, what is one of your favorite adventure movies? Who is a hero that you love to root for? So I look forward to hearing all of your answers. I have Rocky on the mind because we have been using that music and it is wonderful. So I'm curious, what heroes do you like to watch in films or series? Again, welcome everybody, and I'll see you a little bit later on in worship.
Pastor Jane here, and I'm so glad that you are here for this time of worship, exploring the hero's journey. Let's begin our journey today by bringing the Holy Spirit consciously into our being and into our space. So let's breathe in and breathe out. As we breathe in, experience the peace of God, the love of God, the light of God filling you. And as you breathe out, let go of your tension, your fears, your frustrations, your preoccupations. Breathing in, breathing out, experiencing God's peace filling you, wrapping itself around you, connecting you to all there is. Oh, gracious and loving God, we're so grateful for this time together to praise you, to learn more about you, to discover your love in ever greater and deeper ways, and to have an enjoyable time. So may that be true for all of this time together, for all of us, wherever we may be on the journey. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Today's scripture story is the call of Moses, found in Exodus chapter 3 and 4. Moses was shepherding the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the west end of the wilderness and came to the mountain of God. The angel of God appeared to him in flames of fire, blazing out of the middle of a bush. The bush was blazing away, but it didn't burn up. Moses said, "What's going on here? I can't believe this. Why doesn't the bush burn up?" God called to him from out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." Moses said, "Yes, I'm right here." God said, "Don't come any closer. Remove your sandals from your feet. You're standing on holy ground." Then God said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." Moses hid his face, afraid to look at God. "The Israelite cry for help has come to me, and I've seen for myself how cruelly they're being treated by the Egyptians. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the people of Israel, out of Egypt and bring them to a good land with wide open spaces, a land lush with milk and honey." Moses answered God, "But why me? What makes you think that I could ever go to Pharaoh and lead the children of Israel out of Egypt? I'll be with you. Suppose I go to the people of Israel and I tell them, the God of your fathers sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? What do I tell them? I am who I am. Tell the people of Israel, I am sent me to you. Believe me, they will listen to you. And I'll intervene and hit Egypt where it hurts. Oh, my miracles will send them reeling. Moses objected. They won't trust me. They won't listen to a word I say. They're going to say, God, appear to him? Hardly. So God said, what's that in your hand? A staff. Throw it to the ground. He threw it. It became a snake. Moses jumped back, fast. God then said, put your hand inside your shirt. He slipped his hand under his shirt, then took it out. His hand had turned leprous, like snow. God said, put your hand back under your shirt. Moses did it, then took it back out, as healthy as before. Moses said, Master, please, I don't talk well. I've never been good with words. I stutter and stammer. I'll be right with you, with your mouth. I'll be there to teach you what to say. Moses said, oh, Master, please, send somebody else. Then God got angry with Moses. Don't you have a brother, Aaron the Levite? He's good with words. I know he is. You'll speak to him and tell him what to say. I'll be right there with you as you speak, teaching you step by step. Now take the staff in your hand. You'll use it to do the signs. So ends the reading. Like me, and you remember it being more exhilarating than anything you'd ever experienced before, watching that first Star Wars movie. Well, I guess it's now the fourth in the series, but it was the first Star Wars movie that George Lucas made in 1977, and it introduced us to the world of Star Wars and all the main characters and the battle for existence against the evil Galactic Empire. And perhaps you remember how exciting it was from the very first moment of that film, with giant starships looming and flying above you and underneath you and fighting with one another. And then you go into one of the starships, and there's beautiful Princess Leia inserting some information in the little R2-D2 robot. And accompanied by C-3PO, they jettison off into a little pod and land on this deserted, remote planet where, after a couple of fortuitous circumstances, they find themselves in the home where young Luke Skywalker lives with his uncle and his aunt. And Luke is handsome, and he's smart, and he's talented, and he's curious, and he's a big fan of the Rebel Alliance that is fighting the evil empire, and Princess Leia is part of that Rebel Alliance. And you just know right from the start, Luke Skywalker is going to be the great hero of this adventure. And when Luke then learns that there is perhaps some information in R2-D2 that needs to go to somebody in the Rebel Alliance on a planet far away, Luke goes to his uncle and pleads for him to let him leave this farm where he's been living and go out and have an adventure in the world. And you know what his uncle says? No, It's not time yet. I still need you on the farm. Get to your chores. And we as the audience go, what? What? Luke, you need to go out and take this information so that the universe can be saved, and we know that you can do it. What's going to happen when you can't go? Well, we learn not too long after that that circumstances change, and Luke then is able to go and have his adventure and help participate in the battle. And the next main character that he meets that he needs for help to do this is Han Solo, another strapping hero type. He's handsome, he's strong, he's talented, he's fearless. He's also cynical and very transactional in his personality. He'll help Luke Skywalker out because he's this great pilot. And he'll take Luke to the planet that he needs to go to get that information where it needs to go, but for a price. And because he's been to that planet before. Well, when that planet is blown up and then it ends that they have to go right into the middle of the battle, Han says, no, I'm not going there. That's not me. That's not the kind of stuff I do. I've been burned by that kind of behavior before. I'm sorry. You'll need to have someone else do your work for you. Now, these are two scenes that may not be big in our memory of the film because there's so many exciting battles and creatures and so many other things that are happening. But these two small scenes where both Luke and Han reject the opportunity to go on the adventure that they are being called to take are two very important scenes in the trajectory of the story when we look at it from the eyes of the hero's journey, from the lens of the hero's journey, this process for living and that we've been created to have as human beings, this process that we're looking at during this season of Lent. On Wednesday, I introduced this idea of the hero's journey, what that is. It's been described by the great mythologist and scholar Joseph Campbell. And it's a three-part journey that is what our lives are created to experience, starting out in our regular world, and then we feel a call to go do something important, whether it's a discovery that we need to make or an accomplishment we need to have or something that we need to acquire for ourselves or for the world. And then we say yes to that adventure. We go into this supernatural world where there's all sorts of friends and foes and temptations and adventures and love and life and learning. And we get what we need. We get what we've been looking for. And we have a final battle that may take our life. We risk our life for this final battle. We find ourselves rising again after that battle, and we return to the earth with this accomplishment or acquisition or knowledge that makes the world a better place, that makes our lives better, that makes our families better. This trajectory is one that we see in all sorts of novels, in movies, in religious stories, certainly in stories in the Bible. These are all stories that are told to help us understand this journey that we've been created to live, a journey that makes heroes of us all. It's a journey that we might take for the whole of our lives, and also we have separate little journeys that we take as we go along. And today, I want us to look at the second part of this 12-part, or the early part of this early part of this 12-part cycle that Joseph Campbell created. And what I want to talk about is called the refusal of the call. Now, on Wednesday, we talked about the first part of our journey, which is the call to adventure. There's something that we want to accomplish, and we hear God calling, and we want to go and take this journey, this heroic journey. Well, what so often happens in a story and in our life is that once we think about it, we start getting cold feet. We're not sure that journey ahead is something that we're going to be able to do. Or maybe we're afraid we'll do it too well. There's something about that journey that scares us, and so we choose not to take it. Even though the minute before we were really passionate about doing it, we talk ourselves out of it. Or we might refuse the call because someone in our life, a dominating character, doesn't let us go. Or maybe it's our culture or some injustice that doesn't allow the person that we are to take that adventure because of who we're assumed to be. That's the kind of thing that Luke is struck with, and the cold feet is what Han Solo is dealing with. Both these kinds of ways we refuse the call. And it's important for us to acknowledge these scenes, not only because they make us wince, like, I hope that they get over it, but because we get to witness in a story about a hero's journey how, in fact, those characters do move beyond their cold feet or the cold shoulders around them. They find a way to get over their fear and get on the journey. Now, this journey that they need to get onto, that they need to get over their fear to enter onto, can be a big dramatic new adventure, like going to battle or starting a business or leading a cause. Or it could be something that seems smaller, yet is no less scary and dramatic and important. Something like, we look down the road and our new adventure is about confronting an illness, or the loss of a loved one, or perhaps the call to reconcile with a loved one. Perhaps the road ahead is the journey, the adventure of aging, or realizing we have too much stuff. We need to simplify. Any number of those journeys can also scare us and cause us to say, I think I'm going to live where I'm at right now and pretend that that isn't really happening. And perhaps you've had an experience like that, where you have known what's ahead and it's scary and you really just want to avoid it. People that don't choose to get over it and move on to the journey, those are the people that start living what we call lives of quiet desperation, where they're stuck and they're cynical. They find themselves bitter, oftentimes losing themselves in addiction. One of the beauties of these refusal of the call stories and chapters in the whole hero's journey trajectory is it reminds us that this fear can and should be temporary. It's something we need to acknowledge, and then we need to figure out how to move on. Now, we see in our scripture lesson today a quintessential story of a refusal of the call. Poor Moses. And perhaps it surprises you to hear how cowardly Moses is when God comes and offers this incredible opportunity to be a great leader and to help fulfill God's dream for God's people, the biggest dream that God has yet concocted. God is so excited to bring Moses, who's got all the gifts to be a great hero, into this wonderful opportunity. And what does Moses do? He caves. First, I don't think the people are going to know who I am or care what I have to say because I've been at Pharaoh's court all my life. Next. And I don't think people are going to know who you are. And the name that you want to call yourself, I just don't think it's going to go over very well. And, you know, these miracles that you're doing, they're kind of creeping me out. And besides, I don't talk well. It's kind of funny almost the way that Moses just keeps pleading and searching for some new excuse why he can't lead God's charge. And it's kind of funny at the end that God just kind of loses God's temper and says, just stop it. Aaron's going to go with you. Take your staff and go. And we know that Moses does get over it and does lead this amazing journey that has so much meaning for our lives and teaches us so much about what the journey with God is all about. And in fact, if we're looking for help in knowing how to get over our fear when we find ourselves refusing the journey or someone refusing the journey for us, this scripture has great information and teaching for us. Because the thing that God keeps insisting over and over again, as Moses keeps giving excuse after excuse after excuse, is, I am with you. I will give you the words. I will be there to scare off the monsters. I will be there to help you in every way you need. All you really need to do is trust me. In fact, someone was asking me, well, what do we need to pack for our hero's journey? And you know, the number one thing we need to bring with us, wherever we may go on the new path that we're called to take, is faith, is a willingness to open ourselves to trust God, and perhaps trust God completely, because we have nothing else to hang on to. And that's an incredible thing. That can be an incredible plus, too, as we go through our journey. We get to know God so much better as we take these hero's journeys. Our faith gets stronger, and our sense of God's party gets ever greater, and our sense of delight and love for our life just gets greater and greater and greater, because God is with us, and all the gifts that God brings to us in full. So that's one thing that I want you to think about today and this week as we kind of take our journey, our hero's journey. Think about those refusal of the call feelings that you may be having right now as you look ahead at what you feel is the next leg of your journey. What scares you? What in you is trying to talk you out of going ahead? What around you, perhaps, peer pressure, is telling you the direction you want to go is unwise or dumb or won't work? How can your relationship with God and opening to God make a difference? I also invite you to think about who else, what saints, perhaps, might help propel you along. Of course, Jesus, who doesn't have a refusal of the call experience, he's fully courageous right from the start. And there are others who exhibit such great courage that their refusal of the call is really quite brief and quite insignificant, because their journey is so important and they don't have time to refuse the call. Their lives are too much on the line. What I'm thinking of are all the wonderful African-American heroes of our history. There's something about their journey and their courage and their willingness to go ahead and trust God no matter what. I don't know about you, but gives me such strength and encouragement to move ahead, even when I just still feel like sitting where I'm at. And as we think about Moses, the character of Moses in the Bible, I also think about the woman who was named Moses, nicknamed Moses from our history, Harriet Tubman, who was this diminutive little woman who fearlessly brought slaves on the Underground Railroad. How did she do it? Well, she had complete faith, and she just refused to get scared or to talk herself out of it or let anybody talk herself out of it. In fact, I've got a few quotes of hers that I'd like to share with you just to think about as we get ready to move on into your week. May these be a prayer, a blessing for the next stage of your journey. Don't ever stop. Keep going. If you want a taste of freedom, keep going. Every dream begins with a dreamer. Always remember, you have within you the strength, the patience, and the passion to reach for the stars to change the world. It wasn't me, it was the Lord. I always told him, I trust you. I don't know where to go or what to do, but I expect you to lead me. And he always did. And I prayed to God to make me strong and able to fight. And that's what I've always prayed for ever since. I freed 1,000 slaves. I could have freed 1,000 more if only they knew they were slaves. Amen.
My people go down. and mourn. Let my people go and wear those slavery chains forlorn. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt's land. Tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. Come, Moses, you will not get lost. Let my people go. Stretch out your rod and come across. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt's land. Tell old Pharaoh to let my people go.
Thank you, Anna, Christian, and Wayne, for that great song. And now we've come to the time in our service where you're invited to partner in ministry with the church. And we know that there are many different ways to partner, through your time, your talents, your tithes, your gifts. And today we're specifically asking for those financial contributions. So if you'd like to partner with the church, there are three safe and easy ways in which you can do that. You can set up a one-time or recurring gift online at umcps.org/giving. You can always mail in your check to P.O. Box 2007, Palm Springs, California, 92263. Or you can even use your phone right now and text from wherever you are. You just text a dollar amount to the number 760-300-1415. Thank you very much. Every dollar is much appreciated and goes to support life-changing ministry in the church and throughout the community. And I want to extend a special invitation. There are two upcoming events that I think will impact and make a difference in your life. First, we have coming up on Sunday the 28th, if you are interested in exploring how this community can become your church home, you're invited to an informal new member exploration luncheon that'll happen Sunday after worship at 12 o'clock on Zoom. You're invited to bring your lunch, bring your questions, and just learn a bit more about the church and what it means to be a member here. And also, as I mentioned earlier, we're going through a series on Joseph Campbell's work on the hero's journey. And there is an amazing set of interviews with the author exploring his take on this incredible concept. And we are going to have a group who's going to view those interviews together over 6 weeks. That will occur Wednesdays at 3 p.m., and it begins the first week in March, which is March 3rd. So you'll see registrations for both of those in the video description and in the comments. And I hope you'll explore both of those, find some connections, some community, and let your hearts be uplifted. So thank you, everybody. Now over to Pastor Jane.
Hello, Pastor Jane here, and I want to introduce you to the very special person who is going to be serving as our office administrator for the time being. Erin Forget-Wells has taken a job in Las Vegas, and we are so excited that one of our members of our church is temporarily taking her place. So I wanted to introduce you to her now. Ann Doherty, tell us a little bit about you.
Well, I moved to Palm Springs in 2019 from Florida, having lived there for a few years via Minnesota. We moved here because we wanted to golf and hike and bike ride and enjoy the warm weather all year round.
And your journey brought you to our church. Tell us a little bit about how you came to the United Methodist Church and the difference that has made in your life now that you're in Palm Springs.
Well, I met Pastor Jane at a modernism tour one time. And we chatted a little bit about the church. And then I brought a friend who was visiting from Minnesota to church one Sunday. and was just so impressed with the service and the how friendly the congregation was. And I just thought, you know, I think I want to go here. I think I want to get to know these wonderful people some more and really learn a lot more about what my spirituality actually is. And I certainly have really learned a lot through Bible study and, you know, book studies and stuff like that. I'm continuing to learn and grow with that spirituality.
And you have a background in being a bank officer or managing a bank?
I worked for Wells Fargo Bank for 35 years, and I was a bank manager. I was a teller. I was a teller supervisor. I worked in audit the last 15 years. I worked in audit. I was in the audit area. So
it's going to be fantastic having you manage us for a little bit.
Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah. Tell us one more thing, Anne, that you would like us to know about you.
I guess I'd like you to know that my husband and I have gone on 100 cruises. We love to cruise. And so that, you know, we're really, you know, in this trying time right now, we haven't been able to cruise. So we keep hoping that we're going to get on another cruise ship in the next couple of years, at least.
Well, that is wild. And we're glad that you've at least been able to dock here for the pandemic. And it's been wonderful getting to know you. And I'm so glad that you're going to be part of the staff team. And so all of you will know when you stop by the office, if there's somebody here, it's probably going to be Anne.
Yeah, probably. Thanks, I'm really Anne. Looking forward to the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Anne. And thank you for being part of this worship experience today. Indeed, I hope it's been helpful and it's been enjoyable and it blesses your week and your journey ahead. I hope that you'll join us too in our fellowship time that follows our service. The Zoom link is right now in the comment section. And I hope that you'll be joining us for some of the other wonderful events that are coming up that will help us on our hero's journeys this Lenten season. Hear this blessing. And now may the peace of Christ, which is filled with the power of God, that seeks to take you places you never thought you could go, be with you, surround you, and guide you as you leave this place towards those you love, towards those you have yet to meet, towards those people and those things that you fear. And may you indeed discover it makes all the difference for the journey. Amen.